A basic income guaranteed for everyone. It's an idea policymakers and economists have been playing with for some time. Now, a city in the Netherlands will be running the experiment with its citizens in partnership with a local university. They're aiming to find out what participants will do when given enough money to cover living expenses without any strings attached. The last word goes to Ian Lee from Carleton's Sprott School of Business. Hello, Ian. What do you think of the idea? Is this good?
I think it should be explored. It should be studied. We tried this. We did this experiment or something similar to it in Manitoba back in the early 1970s, although obviously the times were very different then. But the issues were the same. If you provide a guaranteed income, does this create a disincentive to work? Does it reduce a person's ambition? And so, because, you know, the argument for a guaranteed annual income is that nobody should be below a certain floor, everybody should have a certain amount to survive. But then that runs up against the objective of society, which is we want as many people working as possible, because, after all, someone's got to pay the taxes.
Absolutely.
So it's a good experiment. It'll be curious to see what the results
are. It will be. I think I base my view on the belief that people have a fundamental need to work and to participate. So I don't worry so much that they're going to go, you know, to the beach every day just because they've got the sustenance. What I like about it, and I hope that this experiment factors in, is that it takes away the disincentive for those who are on that living wage to find additional employment, because that's kind of how the current welfare system is set up. If they participate in the labor market, the benefits get clawed back, and that's not great.
Exactly. And you know, Bruce, to put out even a more provocative idea, one could argue that we have a de facto equivalent of this in Canada, because not only do we have, for example, unemployment insurance, not only do we have social assistance, not only do we have, as we know, subsidized housing for people that qualify, but I argue there's a myriad of other benefits in the system that's below the radar screen that people don't really realize are out there. Let me give you a quick example. 40% of all the pharmaceutical drugs in Canada are paid for by government, because we have pharmacare for low-income people. We have student loans, as special student loans and bursaries for people, for example, for single mothers. And so, you know, if we brought them all together into a single envelope, if you will, a single check, then we would have a better idea of how much people are making. And secondly, what is the incentive-disincentive effect of giving this money?
And if this approach were seen to work in that market and it could be broadly expanded, it would reduce complexity significantly to not have all those programs that people have to source out and take advantage of themselves. I mean, you began with the sort of moral view that this is a good thing, but I you think you could argue it from an economic perspective.
Yes.
Because of the social costs that are associated with people not fully participating in the economy, having mental health issues, having issues of family violence, all those other things that are associated with an insecure income.
Yes, you can make there's a compelling utilitarian argument grounded in economics that you can make. First off, it would consolidate all those costs. You would need far
fewer public servants, primarily in the provincial and municipal bureaucracies, because a lot of those people are doing discretionary work, deciding if you should or shouldn't get the money if you do or don't qualify. And then secondly, we know that things like homelessness on the street is not because there's a lack of housing in Canada. It's because a lot of them have mental challenges or they have drug problems, and part of it is, again, a lack of money. And so this could be a solution down the road to addressing that.
Well, you brought up public servants. You're in Ottawa. I hope you're going to be able to safely leave the studio tonight when you head on home. But it's a perfect segue to our second story, and that is the mayor of Vancouver calling for the city as an employer to become a living wage employer. I think this is a really interesting question, because there's lots of talk about what it takes to actually have a living wage in any city. Vancouver, with its housing costs, that number is quite high. But it seems a bit disingenuous to be looking at it from the city's perspective, given that they're government employees here and they already earn, I think, a larger wage than you would earn if you were working at a retailer or a fast food restaurant.
Bruce, I agree completely. In fact, you can do the two debates we've had, the two subjects. They're a very nice compare and contrast, because in the instance of a guaranteed annual income, you're not regulating the price
of wages. What you're doing is you're giving a check to people below a certain threshold, and then they go out in the market economy and spend it on housing, etc. With the living wage argument, which I am strongly opposed to, the studies have shown, first off, of course it has a negative income, a negative impact on unemployment. If you go and double the minimum wage, you're going to create some unemployment because businesses are not going to use as much labor as they did before. And the second thing that's come out of these studies on living wage is that they're not affecting the people at the bottom, because the people who are getting these living wages tend to be in the lower middle class. So yes, they're benefiting, but you're not getting at the poor, which is the claim of the Canadian Centre of Policy Alternatives, the Mayor of Vancouver, and so forth. They claim they're addressing poverty, but they're really not.
Yeah, here's the other data point we found. 66% of city spending in Vancouver, highest in the country, 66% goes to employee compensation. So I think from a taxpayer perspective, you'd be watching that thing. I mean, I know Vancouver and BC tends to be slightly more left-leaning than the rest of the country, but as a taxpayer in those cities, that might be a hard pill to swallow.
And it distorts, Bruce, it distorts labor markets. And, you know, we've learned from 300 years of theory and practice, we shouldn't be distorting the price mechanism. If we really do want to affect somebody because they're below a certain threshold, then you should be done through redistribution using the tax and redistribution system, not by mucking about with the price by regulating the price of an airplane ticket or a rental unit or a living wage, which is what they're doing.
A pair of interesting stories. Ian, thank you very much.
My pleasure, Bruce.
Appreciate
Thanks.
Your time. Ian Lee, Assistant Professor, Sprott School of Business at Carleton University. And that's tonight's Exchange. Thank you for watching. Stay with the network. Ian Hanna-Mansing is next.